Policy Associate with Sustainable Energy, Sustainable Biomass Energy Program at the Department of Maine Study Institute. ESI is an independent, nonprofit educational organization based here in Washington, D.C. We were founded by the bipartisan caucus, commercial caucus, 25 years ago. We were dedicated to developing innovative policy solutions to address economic, energy, and environmental challenges for our country. And we're looking at that through the eyes of energy efficiency and renewable energy. This briefing continues ESI's exploration of the ways the biomass can help with the nation's environmental, energy, and economic challenges. Looking at ways, policy mechanisms through which we can advance these opportunities to other countries. I'd like to thank a number of groups that have helped make this briefing possible, including McGuire Woods, the Biomass Thermal Energy Council, Rural Voices Conservation Coalition, the Northeast Biomass Thermal Working Group, the Biomass Coordinating Council, and the Public Fuels Institute. We have a wealth of experience assembled here today. People coming from a wide variety of different experiences, perspectives, and regions. We'll help begin our conversation, each with a 10 to 12 minute presentation. But after their presentations, the conversation will go on with your help and some questions. Please stay tuned for that and stick around. Our first speaker today is Steve Painter. Steve is an owner. American Wood Fibers, son of the founder, Frank Painter. As part of the fourth generation, he has been immersed in the wood fiber business his entire life. American Wood Fibers operates 10 plants across the U.S., processing over 500,000 tons of wood and natural fibers annually. Mr. Painter currently serves on the board of directors of the Power Fuels Institute and the Biomass Thermal Energy.
All right, thank you, Ned. Try to make sure that I've got the mic correct for everybody. Thank you to all those organizing and supporting groups to make this possible. As Ned mentioned, I have a little bit of experience in what is now biomass. I have to admit, our company is about 45 years old. My family's been involved in sawdust since 1919, and it's just the last few years that it's actually been called biomass. We just called it sawdust. Or we called it boiler fuel or wood chips. But yes, we're thrilled to be here and talk a little bit about opportunities for biomass to become a thermal solution to our energy future and a win-win for both the environment, for the economy, and for energy down the road. So with that, I'll try to make sure that I go forward and not backwards, and we look forward to questions at the end from you and the audience. I probably have to point it towards it. Yes. Sorry, I got a little excited with the first click. Just a little bit of an outline of my presentation. I think most everybody has them in front of us, so I don't want to be too redundant, but these are the topics that I want to try and cover. We have, as Ned mentioned, several experts on this panel, and there's other subjects that they will cover, but just want to talk about biomass as renewable. It's one that's the number one, and a lot of people don't know that. We're working to get recognition as biomass for fuels and a lot of policy here in Washington. I'll talk a little bit about wood energy growth, largely unsubsidized and unfunded, all independent in a lot of cases. Talk a little bit about residential and commercial appliances, biomass as an advanced biofuel, and then a little comparative information on efficiencies and emissions. So. I don't know that a lot of people realize it, but if you were to pick wind, solar, hydro, electric, geothermal, or biomass, how many of you would have thought biomass was the number one renewable? Be honest. Put those hands up high. Number one. It's not number one by a little bit, it's number one by a lot. Over 50% of our renewable energy comes from biomass, largely thermal, but also in other forms. heating with biomass from a government DOE agency perspective, we've gotten recognized, which is a big accomplishment. Three or four or five years ago on the Hill and agency work, you wouldn't, you'd kind of get that look from folks, biomass, what's biomass? Well, obviously now it's in the consciousness of American people. It's also in the consciousness of Washington. And you can see even the DOE's given a good bit of dedication to it on their websites. And there's a lot of information. You'll see the links below on these slides where you can go and get more information pertaining to that. But there's still a lacking void in policy in the, in America in a federal sense. But on a state level, there are an awful lot of renewable portfolio standards. A lot of them, if you look into the details, this is updated as of just last month, so 29 states have these RPSs. Again, DSIREUSA.org is your link to going there. You can find a huge amount of information on the programs that exist. Many of them have carve-outs. They have carve-outs for a lot of things. Very few of them have carve-outs for biomass, and even fewer have it for biomass thermal. We need to improve that. We need to change that. A lot of good things in renewables out there. Biomass should certainly be part of that conversation. So wood, energy, number one growing fuel. If you look at the census data that just came out from 2010, wood heating by per capita, the number one growing fuel source in America. Why do you think that might be? It's not because of funding. It's not because of support. It's not because of tax breaks. It's because of affordability. We've been through a very difficult time, you know, in our economy, in our country, and folks are trying to figure out ways to heat their homes efficiently and affordably. And they've made it, they've made a decision, as these numbers would suggest, to do it with wood. newer technologies are out there that are very clean burning, low emissions. The EPA has been involved in that and certifying new appliances to improve that. I should probably qualify this, my talk, because I'm probably more focused on pellets than I am maybe chips or biomass, wood pellets being the densified form. But in essence, this is not specific to that. This is 12 million homes in America using wood as energy. but some of these programs the EPA has worked on is to certify these stoves to make them clean. focusing a little bit on this slide, I know it's very difficult to see on a four-page handout. It's even harder over there on the wall, but I'll just point out the key factors that I think are on here. This, again, is talking about heating with biomass in the form of wood pellets. Wood pellets are densified fibers that go through a milling process. They go through a densification process. They get cooled, and primarily they get packaged, and then they get sold for residential home heating. There are about 1 million homes in America with that type of a system. there are lots of stoves, as I mentioned, 12 million are wood appliances that aren't wood pellets, so there's a lot of folks doing this with cordwood and so forth. but if you just look at the wood pellet industry itself, there are over 100 producers in this country. We displace about 8 million barrels of oil. The potential, if you go to some of the studies that have been done, I referred to USDOE earlier, they did a billion-ton study. If you get even somewhat conservative, which we typically are in our industry, you can create a huge amount of energy from this source. And you can create renewable, sustainable energy and jobs. Today, we've got 1,450 direct jobs, countless other indirect jobs supporting our pelleting processing, but the potential is just enormous. You know, almost 820,000 jobs is the estimation, and I know there's some more talk about this later that others will have. That's probably even more specific to this this topic. But that's the picture that we have today. This is just a map showing you some of the different locations. They're spread all over this country. There is a certain bias towards the East Coast, east of the Mississippi in particular. But let's face it, that's where the people are. So that's where the production is. Again, over 100 producers. So if you go to a residential application where you want to heat your home with pellets or with biomass, you've got several different options. These are both two of them are standalone units. One is insert. I think these are both, two of them are wood burning, one of them is pellet. Again, typical home can be space heated or could even be whole house heated with these appliances for about 2 tons of pellets a year. And right now, the market price, you might be at about $500 in fuel. Anybody fill an oil tank lately? You can't fill an oil tank for $500. Not anywhere in our country right now, unless your tank is really small. Most aren't. So that's the residential market. This is a potential that's been identified and something that's been worked on through several universities and also commercially now to take biomass and use it as the fuel for confined animal feeding operations. Poultry is one great target where you have 500-foot-long home houses where these birds get grown and essentially brought to maturity and then sent to be converted for food, let's just say. There are a lot of these out there. There's 90,000 homes in America, or excuse me, 90,000 or so poultry houses, a huge opportunity within that industry. And there's a map on the next slide that shows you where the potential lies. We eat a lot more chicken than we do turkey, although a lot of us, I'm sure, are planning our eating wisely so that we have room for turkey next week. But the chicken growers are down primarily in the southeast and through the Carolinas. You've got turkey growers throughout the Midwest and down through those areas as well. The bottom line is there's a lot of birds, there's a lot of energy, and these kind of systems would be a great opportunity to, again, create energy with biomass. Talk a little bit about institutional opportunities. And these are a couple of examples that are out there in the marketplace. I will give credit here to the Biomass Energy Resource Council, BERC, acronym for that. And they have a great website that has a ton of information. And this is where I glean this these two particular systems. They have lots on there, institutional, something for colleges, universities, for correctional facilities, all kinds of opportunities in biomass here. And again, these folks in the first example that I'll highlight, they're able to save $2 million a year in expenses on fuel on a $4 million system. That's pretty decent payback. I'd certainly invest in it. So I want to, without being argumentative, without being trying to throw anyone under the bus, we need a lot of solutions to our energy future. But I do want to compare this one as it relates to advanced biofuels, which wood pellets qualify, as do lots of liquid biofuels that are essentially not corn converted, you know, converted ethanols and so forth. This is a challenge that was put out by the Biofuels Digest for a victory plant, and I'll go through it quickly. They want to produce $1.50 per gallon fuel, ASTM certified, for a $4 per gallon capacity capital investment in 24 months or less. Sounds pretty interesting. Sounds pretty compelling. Reality is they're not close to this right now. That's okay. Maybe they'll get there. Maybe they won't. Let me just give you an example of what you can do with a pellet operation. This happens to be a picture of my plant in Virginia. It's on 40 acres. It's a pretty good sized facility. 1 ton of pellets, to give you an equivalent, is about 2.8 barrels of oil. 2.8 barrels of oil equal 117 gallons. You do the conversions of pellets at a pretty good wholesale price of $177 a ton. That equals out to $1.50 per gallon. I know it's not liquid. I know you're not going to put it in your car, although people are actually powering cars with pellets. It's probably not what you want to do, but this is an opportunity to do it in an equal fashion with densified fuels. The capacity of our plants, 8.5 million gallons, give or take. We did it for less than $2 a million gallon investment. So who's the victor? All right, so we've gotten even smaller with slides, and I apologize again. But these will be available on the EESI website. So please feel free to go there and download them. This is just a simple comparison with today's heating prices for different fuels, comparing number two, oil, diesel, electricity, propane, and wood. And you can see that wood is about half the cost pretty simple. It's not rocket science. The last thing I'll leave you with is just some efficiency numbers and emissions. Biomass to thermal has the highest energy conversion today. Ethanol, we can argue about what that conversion factor is, 1-to-1, 2-to-1. I won't argue that. Pellets are somewhere between 15-to-1. 15 units of energy out for every unit of energy you put in. 15-to-1. If you put it in a bag, it's a little bit less. But that's a great number. The other is the emissions and the cleanliness, and others will probably address this or can probably speak to this better than I can, so I won't go into that too deeply. But the essential thing to leave you with is that the EPA is working with the industry to create clean emissions. Sometimes it's a little onerous with the boiler max and so forth, but the reality is we need clean technologies. We have to be aware of that, and these technologies can be and certainly are already today. So I thank you for your time. I hope you were able to glean some information you didn't have, and I look forward to questions later. Thank you.
The next speaker is Bill Strauss, who's president and founder of Future Metrics, a consultancy specializing in quantifying the financial feasibility of renewable energy projects and quantifying the economic impacts of these projects. It's been a busy year for Bill. He's been a keynote speaker at two major international bioenergy conferences, one at the World Climate Conference in Rome, Austria, in March, and the International Bioenergy Conference in, Linköping. He has an MBA in finance and a PhD in economics and earth system science.
Thank you. We have a little mic issue here. I'll be very quick today. We have limited time, and I have a lot of information on this slide deck. It's about 25 or so slides, so we'll blast through it. But the slide deck will be available for download later, and you can take a very close look. So we'll go through it pretty quickly, and it's also going to be hard to see on the screen. But this first slide says essentially, why should we care about renewable energy? And I know you can't see it, but the time scale there is from the year zero to the year 3000. And we're at about the year 2000. And that big peak is oil production. And oil was basically, production started in the mid-1800s. It's continuing now. And I'm not sure where that trough finally hits. Is it 2050? Is it 2100? But it's going to happen. So we need to pay attention. And this is my take on U.S. energy policy right now. I know I'm in the place where I shouldn't be throwing around rocks, but that's what we're up to. And I think we have some solutions for this. So the discussion I'm going to bring forth here is about, sort of follows exactly what we just heard about the use of wood fuels, particularly pellets, as a source of heating. And I'm going to concentrate on the Northeast states. That's where my company is expert. That's where we do most of our work. And that's where we're located. We're located in Maine. This chart shows you the petroleum dependency of the various Northeast states. The dark lines are the New England states, plus Pennsylvania and New York. Hawaii is off the chart there. But the other dark lines, the next two are New Hampshire and Vermont. And then we go down from there. Maine is the next bar. Heavily petroleum dependent, and the reason basically is because of dependence on heating oil. This slide shows you the percent of households using heating oil. Maine is the winner. We're excluding Alaska, by the way, here. At about 70, a little over 70% of Maine's homes are dependent. New Hampshire, Connecticut, Vermont, Rhode Island, all the New England states. So that's why when we talk about changing people or people's heating oil addictions, we're really heavily concentrated on the Northeast. Northeast states use about a little more than 80% of the heating oil used in the United States. That's where the problem is. And I know this slide is hard to read, both on the handout and up on the screen, but essentially what I'm quantifying here for you is what I'm calling, this is the amount of money that's exported every year. That's a big number down in the bottom right corner. That's $20 billion every year exported out of these states. Sent away. And along with that money, and you guys can take a close look at the data there later on. I'm not going to go through that table of numbers. But along with all that money is jobs. That $20 billion takes about a million jobs with it, and off they go away from the New England states. Our dependence on home heating oil in the Northeast is destroying about a million jobs. That's a very dramatic number. In fact, this little cartoon, which an associate of mine wrote, I think sums it up. There's a truck filling somebody's home with foreign oil, if you will. Somebody's taking some money to the Middle East Treasury, and up in smoke coming out the stack is jobs. So there you have it. One of the reasons that we think that this business of making pellets is so important is because very few homes in some of the states in the Northeast have natural gas. Infrastructure is non-existent in Maine. Only 4% of Maine's homes have natural gas and have the ability to connect. It's a very rural, low-density state, so there's no money to be made by utilities in bringing natural gas infrastructure to homes. The only natural gas in Maine goes to paper mills, and that's about it. Hawaii is the lowest, by the way. They have none. And then Vermont and New Hampshire are next after Maine. And even a big state like New York is only 55%. That means 45% of the homes in New York do not have natural gas infrastructure, do not have access to cheap natural gas. They are dependent on expensive foreign oil. So what's the opportunity? This slide actually shows you the percent timberland in the Northeast states, the very same states that we're just talking about that are dependent on heating oil and don't have much natural gas infrastructure. Maine leads the pack. It's close to 90% of Maine is forest land. And most of that forest land has been managed for decades, in fact, centuries. It's kind of like if you think of a farmer managing their farm and growing corn every year and then harvesting that at the end of the year. Not much different than what's done in Maine, except it takes about 30 to 40 years to grow the crop. It's grown, then harvested, then regrown. That's the way forests are managed in Maine and have been for generations, actually. There's plenty of wood. We'll talk a little bit about sustainability very quickly here as I get towards the end of this discussion. I know I'm going quickly. I apologize. Our thesis here is what if we could convert some of these homes that are on heating oil over to regionally produced wood pellet fuel? Job destruction would become job creation. And there's really simply three effects here. The money spent on the fuel stays in the economy instead of going to treasuries in Venezuela or the Middle East or wherever. The fuel is a lower cost. As we just heard, pellet fuel is actually quite cheap. It's about half the cost of heating oil. In the equivalent of heating oil, it's about $1.80 a gallon right now. And heating oil in Maine is about $3.65. And, of course, the supply chain for producing the fuel creates jobs as well. From the forest to the production mills to the homeowners, there's a whole infrastructure for supply chain. So how much of the Northeast can be converted? It really depends on sustainable, right? We have to talk about the sustainable quantities. If we're not managing our forests sustainably, we're just like every other depleting resource. We're no better. We're killing off the future. But forest lands in Maine and many of the other Northeast states have been sustainably managed for decades. The forests in Maine are actually growing more than they're being harvested. They're actually getting bigger every year rather than smaller. We also could take a look at idle croplands that could be converted to dedicated energy crops. That's an important component that we have to investigate as well. And we also have to pay attention to other uses of biomass products that already have value, like pulp and paper and lumber making. That has to be in the equation. So here's a picture of Maine's annual harvest for the last, since 1980. And it's essentially been sustainable. It's somewhere around 17 million tons a year. The rule of thumb up in that neck of the woods is about 1 ton per year per acre is the growth rate. So if you have 20 million acres of forest land, you're going to grow 20 million tons a year of forest. If you harvest 20 million tons, the next year that 20 million tons will reappear as new growth. So as long as it's sustainably harvested, and as you can see, it has been in Maine pretty consistently, you're good for the long term. You're not depleting the stock. Very quickly, these are a few slides on wood pellets. This is one of my companies, Maine Energy Systems. That boiler in the bottom left is one of our systems that lives in people's homes. It replaces oil boilers. It's fully automatic, clean, reliable, doesn't take any attention from the homeowner. They don't even know it's there. It's bulk fuel fed, so the homeowner doesn't even have to put pellets in it. It's all automatic. The truck on the right is one of our fuel delivery trucks. It looks just like an oil delivery truck, except it delivers wood pellets through a hose. It's pneumatically injected into the storage tank. That home, in fact, is one of my partner's homes. It's a ski home in western Maine. It's about $1 million home, heated with that boiler that you see on the right. That's a wood pellet boiler, Austrian technology. It works just fine. You can leave the home for a month, and the home still isn't frozen when you go back to it. It stays warm. Quickly on emissions, a lot of people say, well, aren't they dirty? Aren't they a mess? We do have a laser on this, I think. It's hard to see. You can't really see it. Down at the bottom, well, you have the handout. You can see that the modern European pellet-fueled boiler is about the same particulate emissions as a modern heating oil boiler. They're almost identical. Then if you move up the scale there, you can see older boilers, oil boilers are a little dirtier, pellet stoves, somewhat more particulate, and then you go up to fireplaces, which are really nasty. And as a matter of fact, I love this slide. This shows you that if you burn a cord of wood in your fireplace, you're going to put out 375 pounds of particulate. And if you burn the equivalent amount of pellets in your boiler, you're going to put out about 0.28 pounds of particulate. So everybody likes to sit around their fireplace. Maybe you should stop. Get a pellet boiler. They're really clean. You don't even know they're running. This one I know you can't read. This goes to what's the future. This shows that in Europe, biomass is about 65% to 70% of renewables, and that sort of follows in what you said. The next biggest is hydro at 18 or 19, and then we have wind power at 7, geothermal at 6, and solar about 1.5. Biomass is the workhorse of renewable in Europe, and it is in the U.S. as well. It should get on the radar, and I know it's not sexy, but it matters. Very quickly, I know I'm running out of time, and I just have a few more slides. Quick case study. I was in Sweden a few weeks ago, very impressed by the economy. The upper right slide, you can't quite see the top of it, shows you fossil fuel energy consumption as a percent of total energy. The U.S. is the dark line that doesn't really go any lower than where it starts back in 1960. Sweden has gone from about 80% down to a little over 30%. And the bottom right slide shows you the percent of that that's biomass. The U.S. is basically a flat line at about 4%. Sweden's up over 20 now. And you'd think, wouldn't this mess up their gross domestic product per capita? Well, there's U.S. and Sweden superimposed. They're almost identical. In fact, Sweden's actually a little higher than the U.S. today. Their economy's doing just fine. And finally, as an added benefit, if we one day when we start caring about carbon emissions, U.S. carbon emissions are actually increasing. Sweden's are actually decreasing and quite a bit lower. And chart shows you CO2 per year if you burn 1,000 gallons of heating oil. In this case, we're not calling pellet fuel carbon neutral because we're considering the diesel fuel necessary to transport the stuff from the woods to your home, and et cetera. So it takes a little bit of carbon fuel. But the combustion is carbon neutral. So finally, to sum it up, the Northeast does have all the right stuff. In fact, much of the United States, I don't want to be totally Northeast-centric, much of the northern tier where heating is very, very important has the right stuff. As long as you have forests sufficient enough to maintain stable harvests and sustainable harvests, you're in good shape. And this one is way busy. I'm violating all the slide rules with too many words. But essentially it says that we have fuel refineries, we call them pellet factories. We have bulk delivery systems and boilers. There's a link to my company, Maine Energy Systems. Lots of schools, municipal buildings, government buildings of all kinds have already converted throughout the Northeast and in many other parts of the country. And the forest products sector has a long history of being a key part of the economies in the North, and it needs to be maintained because pulp and paper is on the wane. Pulp mills are shutting down everywhere. And what's going to replace that demand? What's going to keep those people working? What's going to keep the working forests working? We think it's energy. And finally, the penalty for failure is dire. This shows you that if heating oil goes from the current price of $3.65 to $4.50 a gallon, it's going to evaporate 238,000 jobs. Just approximately $1.50 increase in heating oil prices, that's that much more money exported and that many more jobs gone. And that's the end, triple E solution, economic growth, energy independence, and environmental stewardship. Thank you.
Next speaker is David Atkins. He's the Woody Biomass Program Manager at the US Forest Service State and Private Forestry Branch. He's been 33 years with the Forest Service, 20 years in land management, and the past 11 years working on small woods utilization. In 2001, he started and implemented the Fuels for Schools and Beyond initiative, demonstrating and developing small-scale wood heating systems in the interior west. Since then, he has worked with communities, states, and private sector across the country in wood energy. He has a BS in forestry and a master's degree in forest development.
Thank you.
It's great to be able to have the opportunity to come and share the experiences that I've had relating sustainable forest management to wood-to-energy opportunities and how they can complement each other. So I want to start off with a little flight of fancy or imagination. So imagine an organic solar collector with organic batteries that store that energy that gets collected. And further, imagine that the array of these solar collectors provides a complex habitat structure for a wide range of plants and animals. And also imagine that this organic battery from these solar collectors can be converted to structures that can provide human habitation. And these solar collectors with organic batteries can filter carbon from the atmosphere. It also provides a water storage and filtration system and can help mitigate intense water storm events and flooding. And oh, by the way, it also produces oxygen that we breathe. So obviously this doesn't have to be invented. It's something that's already here. But forests tend to be something that we just take for granted. It's there, and it provides this whole range of things. And I think it's important for us to step back and put that into perspective. So sustainable forest management, for what and for whom? We've got 750 million acres, roughly, of these solar collector and organic batteries spread across this country. And they're owned by a wide range of family forest owners, public, some of it's federal, some state, some county and local, and a portion, a relatively small portion, by corporate interests. And so these landowners have a whole variety of reasons why they own that land and what they manage it for. And I've listed out a number of those, whether it's aesthetics and recreation, wildlife habitat, dealing with wildfire risk management, and that's a big issue out west, dealing with insects and diseases that can affect those forests, climate change mitigation, adaptation of those forests as climate change is occurring, and wood production. And often people are producing and managing their forests for a whole mixture of these purposes. It's fairly uncommon to have it just focused on one of those. So out west, wildfire is a major consideration and has been for a number of years. And so that's that upper picture is from the Wallow Fire in Arizona just this past June. The pile of forest debris burning there on the lower left is from some forest management activities, and in the West, in most of the states, you're required to dispose of that residue, that slash we call, to reduce the wildfire hazard. And so the most common way that is done is by burning that slash. The other option is to utilize that for energy, and I hit the wrong button. The that white there is water condensation. When you're burning wood chips, there's moisture in that wood, and as it gets driven off and hits the cold atmosphere, then it condenses, and you'll see that water vapor. So here's that wallow fire in Arizona, and some management that was done. And so you can see from that arrow, the red arrow, that the fire was coming in the direction of the photo point. And the black in the background is where you had that running crown fire that you had a picture of previously. In that middle zone, that's where there had been some harvesting and treatment of the forest to reduce the density and reduce that fire hazard. And because of that, they were able to have the crews and the equipment in place to protect the homes that were down in the area that is green there. So this is just another location associated with that fire, but the same sort of thing. You have this thinned area, some homes down here. You can see the fire ran through there. You know, it didn't stop the fire, but it radically changed the fire behavior from a raging 150-foot wall of flames to something that was on the ground that made it manageable. I think it's really important to keep in mind that woody biomass rides the coattails of other management purposes. Whether it's higher value wood products, then you're milling that wood into lumber, window trim, paper, whatever. Energy is typically pretty low on the food chain of wood values. We also ride the coattails of a lot of other objectives, whether that is thinning to reduce the wildfire hazard, as we just saw, or modify and improve wildlife habitat, or do watershed protection kinds of things. And so all of these things generate some woody biomass, and we have the opportunity to utilize that material. We also have forest health issues, and I suspect many of you have heard about the mountain pine beetle epidemics that have been affecting Colorado, Wyoming, Montana, and other parts of the West in very large ways, and killing extensive amounts of trees. We have other pests like the spruce budworm and many others. And we often want to do treatments that can reduce the risk of those being severely impacted either by the fire or the insects and the diseases. And here's an example of a project that we worked on developing some new ways to gather and collect and process that biomass and utilize it rather than just piling it and burning it. So we have existing systems, and we've had some descriptions of that. And within the wood products industry, for many decades, wood's been used for energy. There are a few university and college campuses, and I got a couple up there that converted in the 80s and 90s, and more of them have been converting in the recent years to that. And the fuels for schools, this Darby was our first one that became operational. And so I'll just go over a little bit of the results from Darby. It replaced fuel oil with wood chips, became operational in fall of 03. In that first year, oil was only about $1 a gallon, and they saved about $30,000 that year. In year five, it was up around $350 a gallon, and they saved about $140,000. So far in this 8 years, they've saved about $800,000. The cost to convert this system, there were actually three schools that had separate fuel oil boilers and went to one wood-fired boiler. It cost about $850,000. So they've almost got that paid back. The useful life should be 30 years or more. A teacher salary at Darby is about $30,000 a year. So you can see the significance to that school in terms of its capacity for teaching, and what they have to request from their community in terms of taxes to support that school. Okay, so here's just a picture of some of the equipment inside, and just trying to illustrate that this is high-tech stuff. It's computerized, it's automated. You're not having to have somebody shoveling wood chips out back. This is a new construction, and it's something I want to touch on just briefly. This was a high school in Kalispell, Montana, that wood was incorporated into that design from the beginning. The really significant piece there is if you incorporate that design into the construction from the beginning, the cost is about half of what a retrofit would be. And so we need to be thinking about getting connected with architects and engineers and incorporating that at the beginning stages, because then that makes the return on investment even better. The jobs piece of it that Bill was talking about, we're talking about production, transportation, manufacturing, just some images that reinforce that occurring in a local area. This is a different way of displaying the cost differences. So the bar on the left is fuel oil, and these are all converted to dollars per megajoule, so that it's consistent. But you can just see that just visually there's a real dramatic difference. Here's pellets and there's wood chips. Natural gas is currently quite low compared to what it was just a few years ago. And we've seen those cycles, and I expect we will see them again in the future. But that fuel oil and propane provides a great opportunity for economic savings. So the take-home message here is that we can utilize a renewable, domestically produced energy form that has a whole bunch of co-benefits. That wildfire hazard mitigation, watershed protection, wildlife habitat, air emissions, all of those kinds of things that you don't have those co-benefits with other forms of energy. It can save money and create jobs, and at the same time reducing our dependence on foreign oil. So on my email sign-off, I have that little line there: if you don't grow it, you mine it. You know, we get into all kinds of debates about things and whether we should be doing this or whatever, and often it gets presented as a choice of doing nothing or doing something. But the reality is it's doing something or doing something. And what's that other something? Wood and forests that are managed sustainably provide us an opportunity to maintain that something in perpetuity. Thank you.
Forest Stewardship Program of Sustainable Northwest. Sustainable Northwest brings people, ideas, and innovation together so that nature, local economies, and rural communities can thrive. Chad works with Forest Stewardship Program partners and communities to make them opportunities and strengthen market channels for byproducts of ecologically based forest stewardship. Chad's interest in market-based conservation strategies create opportunities for rural communities during the sustainable Northwest. Chad is the co-chair of the Biomass and Energy Working Group of the Rural Voices for Conservation Coalition, and also co-chairs the Urban Forest Biomass Working Group.
I'm wondering what I said caused everybody to leave.
I know.
Sorry.
We were just getting to the fun part, too. So those of you that know me know that I will be fast, and sometimes we'll go on, so I'm going to try not to go on, but I guarantee you I will be fast. RVCC, the Rural Voices for Conservation Coalition, is a policy coalition that Sustainable Northwest runs that has mainly made up of Western rural community folks. And the policy solutions that we try to advance are those that simultaneously address the ecological and the economic challenges that faces the rural communities of the West. And as an example of that, in terms of biomass, what that means is using the byproducts of the forest restoration activities that are happening on our national forest lands as a source of local fuel. And so that's how I tie in with this great setup of folks here. I'm going to talk about three kind of concepts that are probably not going to show up there because of the graphics. The first one, though, you have them in front of you, is parity. And I think if I was to summarize real quickly in one word what we're after on this thermal kind of platform is recognition, recognition, recognition. At some level, we need to recognize that thermal energy exists and that it's important to our energy portfolio and that we can't have a comprehensive energy strategy without it. So what that normally means when folks come to you and probably talk about biomass parity means the Section 45 production tax credit because of the open-looped and the closed-loop differences of rate. But that won't do it. We cannot achieve parity in our energy portfolios without some inclusion of the thermal sector. These gentlemen have talked about the various benefits for it, and without it, we won't get there. And where it truly starts to strike a balance is that biomass is extremely efficient at producing heat energy. And this parity in an energy policy actually creates parity for our communities in terms of equitable access to producing their own energy. If you live in a very rural, very displaced community across the West, there's not a transmission line within 30 miles of you or even farther. So how are you going to recruit any kind of energy into your community? You also import everything that you buy. You import the gas that goes in your tank for your pickup. You import the heating oil that goes into your boiler at home, and you import the energy off the grid that comes to you. So how can our communities, without this parity, start to establish their own local sources of fuel? Markets is the second piece, market development in particular. To date, most of our focus has been on, particularly as it relates to biomass, has been on using more biomass. We've got to use more biomass for energy. We've got to use more biomass for energy. Particularly, that's the policy that we've been doing. I've got the Oregon outlined here in a halo, of course, because it's the greatest state in the union. But other than that horrible graphic, what this has meant is that policies have attempted to get the additional resource to the existing facilities. And so those are just a snapshot of what Oregon might or might not look like in terms of our biomass energy sector currently today. But rather, we need demand drivers for market development that will effectively densify these market opportunities for this material and reduce the transportation of this material all over the state and all over our nation. And so I've kind of populated here, and actually these are somewhat ground truth in some kind of institutional school heat projects that these gentlemen have been referring to that have popped up across the state of Oregon in the last 3 years. And if you think a little bit bigger than that about the process heat opportunities, which Steve mentioned in terms of the poultry production in the south, we have a lot of food and seafood manufacturing facilities, very similar type of sector in Oregon, and those would be a little bit bigger facilities. But the map looks very different if we densify it rather than trying to get it all over the place. I think the take home there is whatever we put the incentive towards, we end up getting more. So if we put this incentive, if we need more markets, if that's what we really need, then why not put the incentives towards developing more markets? I'm going to tie this just to jobs just for a second, since that's a primary important piece of this. We in the forest sector talk about biomass as of creating forest sector jobs, loggers, foresters, those kind of folks. We have boiler manufacturers in this country. We have energy service providers in this country who are ready to get into this business. And we've started to see that some in Oregon in some of these projects in particular. Three little biomass heat projects at schools. I just talked to both the boiler manufacturer that's located right 30 miles from my house and the energy developer who lives in Portland. Three school projects created 7,000 man hours of jobs. That's three full-time jobs. Three full-time jobs is not crazy significant, but for every project, we basically got a full-time job. That is pretty significant. The facility you see up here is the newest pellet plant in Oregon. It's out in John Day, Oregon. It's 17,000 miles from nowhere. I promise you can't get there from here. It created 15 new jobs in a community with 17% unemployment. 15 jobs doesn't sound like a lot. That's 6% of the non-farm workforce in that county. 6%. So we could potentially go from 17 to 11 with one little facility. That is pretty significant. And it was pretty awesome to have the woman in the top left is CEQ Chair Nancy Sutley, which we were fortunate to host her out there and gave her a new perspective in thinking about how this administration could think about its a comprehensive energy strategy and also thinking about biomass energy in particular. Dave mentioned forest restoration opportunities, and I want to tie this back into it just a little bit. We have an opportunity with our energy policy to think even more than just about what the energy outcomes are going to be with it, particularly if you think about it in terms of biomass. The market value for biomass towards a thermal end is much higher than towards cellulosic ethanol or towards electricity these days. And so if we say we have options on the table in terms of that's what this chart is trying to get at. If we have three options, or a couple different options. The top line would be electricity option, 25 megawatt power plants dispersed across the state. The middle line is meant to represent kind of smaller scale combined heat and power facilities and district energy projects, which are very common throughout Europe. And the bottom line is the schools, hospitals kind of path, if you think about them. This is merely a numbers exercise, but just to illustrate a point right quickly. The Oregon Forest Resource Institute says that we have 1.5 million bone dry tons of material available from these restoration projects on an annual basis. Take that number and run with it. If we slice that 1.5 million tons up in one of these three platforms, just go across and you see what happens in terms of number of facilities. The important point is this column right in the middle where it's price per ton. You don't need to necessarily be a forester to understand that 80 is better than 30 when you're getting paid for it, although some foresters might not understand that. So, and how that translates, though, is really in these two last columns. The value put back into our local economy by paying more for a product to pay those loggers to get it out of the woods is drastically significant. And if you tie that back to our forest restoration goals and assume a $350 per acre number to treat those acres, that additional revenue turns into a lot more acres treated. And what that does, because us as taxpayers and everybody in this room pays to get those acres treated, we have a fire issue and we're taking care of it and we're moving forward on that. The issue is how do we pay for it? And from our perspective, prioritizing biomass for thermal uses is one way to help to start to fix that stopgap. It's not the only solution out there that needs to be pursued in that avenue, but it is one that could be used a lot more than it is. And oh, by the way, we've all talked about reducing energy costs. If we offset all of that energy production in one state, if we offset heating oil and propane, we're talking in the neighborhood of $100 and $140 million. That's across the residential sector, the public sector, and across the private sector as well in terms of those process heat users. So we have a significant opportunity to do a lot of different things. So in summary, a recapitulation, my southern tongue doesn't like that word, a recapitulation of biomass energy policy would result in significant increases in economic value of biomass, help fund more acres of restoration across the West and more broadly, and drastically reduce energy costs in our rural communities that are dependent on heating oil and propane right now. And that's all I have.
The big challenge really comes down to investment in the technology. Because of the uncertainty that, you know, promulgates from either the actions or the inactions of a certain environmental protection agency here in Washington, you have folks deciding or not deciding, you know, about projects. So it if you are a boiler manufacturer and you're trying to scale up your, you know, technologies to bring them to market, and the EPA is out there not sure what they're going to do, basing some of their analysis on, you know, the very top level technology that's really a very suspicious select way to average out, you know, the best available control technologies or the most achievable and so forth. I mean, the uncertainty is the biggest issue, because it just brings the investments to a halt. You can't pin it, you can't pencil it, you can't finance it. And some of the analysis, and I'm not the expert on that, I guess I mentioned it, so you addressed the question to me, but again, you know, I think the numbers were something about, like, you know, the top 12 percent of the technologies became the basis for 88% of the boilers. I mean, it's crippling, and I think you saw the actions by Congress by I think it was H.R. 2250, which was a EPA relax yourself bill. I can't remember the exact name, but I think it was 2250. Relief, thank you. EPA relief or Regulatory Relief Act was a big one. That sort of, you know, that was a big statement by Congress, from the House at least. So that would be the biggest issue, is just moving technologies forward and getting adoptions in a very uncertain climate when you don't really know which way EPA has gone. EPA has worked very closely with some of us on, like the Pellet Fuels Institute, for example, has gone through an exhaustive, and I don't say that lightly, it's been about a 5-year process to get standards established for pellet fuels. I always liken it to, you go to your pump and put gas in your car, and you've got 87 octane, 89, and 91. It's not exactly how you do it with pellets, but you've got different grades of pellets that the EPA has now given us their endorsement, and we're actually waiting for them with the new source performance standards to come out, which has been, a process that has delayed over time. It was supposed to be, I'll probably get these all wrong, but 2 years ago, supposed to be a year and a half ago, supposed to be a year ago, supposed to be this fall, now it's going to be next June. I don't know when it's going to be, but the standards have been established, at least in that sector. So we've had a lot of cooperation in some areas, but the Boiler Act is a huge issue, and I don't know the boiler folks, maybe Bill or you, maybe better.
No, I'm not better. Because the home the Austrian style technology that we're using actually meets those proposed standards, so we're not threatened by it. But we understand, particularly on the larger size systems, the issues that have been raised that are very important, and I think they were quite well articulated.
My name is Raj Williams, and my company is Green Sensitive Design. Dave, I think you and I should be talking. You were talking about architects and design people getting involved in the beginning of a process, and I think that's an excellent point. I loved all of your presentations. I think this is an excellent topic, and I wanted to mention, Steve, the product that you're talking about, I really think it's very critically important, and being in the one of the services that we provide is energy efficiency of buildings. And it's really tied with the national security issue of not being dependent on foreign oil. And it's not enough if you are efficient with your facilities, but in addition, you need renewables. And I believe biomass is as carbon neutral as it gets, because if you leave it in the forest to biodegrade by itself, it's going to release carbon. But if you're going to be using it to generate energy, I really think it's a win-win situation. And I just thought, you know, I just wanted to make that point that it's really a positive to the environment than being a negative. And I really appreciate all of the presentations. Thank you.
John Harris, Energy Resource Professionals Group. This is for anybody on the panel, and particularly Dave, you may hit this one. Could you touch on the value in the system and its payback if you're able to run it 12 months and include cooling, the impact on peak production in the summertime, the peak on capital utilization, and the ability to basically stabilize the economics of the system.
That, people got it. Okay. One of the colleges I had a picture of up there was Shadron State College in northwest Nebraska, and they actually do heating with their biomass in the wintertime and cooling with the summertime with their biomass. And so it's definitely improves the economics because they're getting better utilization of their investment in the boiler system throughout that, and so there are opportunities to do that, and one of the things that we learned, you know, with a K-12 school, you know, it's only occupied, you know, a certain period of time during the day, you know, typically not on weekends and, you know, not during the summer. If you compare that to, say, a hospital or a prison where you've got people in there 24/7, 365, the heat usage and the cooling usage is greater throughout, and so then that improves the economics of the installation of these kinds of systems. Does that get at what you were asking, John? Yeah, and this, you know, Shadron State College is a good example of that, where you make the investment in that biomass boiler, and you can use that boiler to drive the cooling system. And I know that's kind of an odd thing to think about for a lot of people, but think about a propane cooler in people's RV. You know, you're burning propane to cool it, and so the opportunities exist throughout the country to have the biomass serve as an energy offset of current fossil fuels.
If I could add real quickly, you know, I mentioned about the CAFOs, the confined animal feeding operations, and you have to keep in mind that even though there may be some areas of the country where you think, well, it doesn't really get that cool, or it doesn't get, you know, really cold, and they don't need the thermal. They have to get some of those heating, those houses up to like 115 degrees when they bring these young, tiny birds in to get them, you know, the right environment for them to grow. It still takes, I mean, if you got an 80-degree day, you're not there. So there's a lot of load in some of those cases that aren't, you know, it's not a northeast-centric sort of challenge that we face. It is around the country, and there's an awful lot of examples. I mean, throughout the Mid-Atlantic, I mean, there's a correctional facility on the Eastern Shore in Maryland that uses it for both power and thermal, and then they also use it for their hot water. And you can imagine, you know, I don't know, there's a lot of inmates in that particular one. They got dirty laundry. You got to clean that stuff. That's a lot of water. So there's a lot of different applications, I think, that broaden that demand. And it's also, when you keep in mind the different renewables that are out there, wind and solar are dependent upon certain environmental factors to give them efficiencies. Wind's got to blow, sun's got to shine. Biomass thermal is constant. It runs when you want it. Runs when you need it.
For reasons of time, we didn't have a representative of the Midwest, which would be the other key region, or the South for that matter, to present additional perspectives in terms of biomass utilization in different regions. But when you look at the map of the United States in terms of propane dependence versus heating oil dependence, it's a very different map. And so you're looking at the Midwest, rural Midwest, and rural South as being much more propane and electric power dependent for their heating sources. And both of those are very expensive. Electricity is a very expensive way to heat your house. And so when you look at the competitiveness of biomass there, it's, it really is as a national scope, as well as the 12 months.
Hi, Amanda Katurka from Environment and Energy Publishing. You had mentioned that your goal here is you're looking for recognition. But as you're here in D.C., are you asking for any specific federal policies from Congress? I mean, is there anything the federal government can do to help you?
Yeah, I think so. So, I mean, we've obviously visited with some offices today and thinking about, you know, the current state of Congress. I mean, there are some. If you look across the existing tax codes and things, there are some gaps that don't necessarily address biomass thermal. Is a tax incentive politically viable right now is a different question. There's no doubt that part of the issue with building out a market is addressing capital, upfront capital. There's a variety of ways to think about how to do that, and I think that's one of the particular policies that could get at it. The other thing with that I've been talking to some folks about in particular is how do we give recognition without some kind of, you know, particular piece of tax piece of legislation or a renewable thermal standard, just to throw that concept on the table. And I've been talking to folks about simple things, like is there a need for some kind of thermal resolution, just to say that the sense of Congress is that it's a priority, to help start to give some direction to some of the agencies out there that have existing programs of work. Some programs are underprescribed, some are way overprescribed. And that would give our colleagues an opportunity to start to talk to folks in the agencies about ways that they could implement that vision of Congress. And so it's not necessarily always about money, money, money. I think there are some money things that we could look at. But there are existing pots of money in the agencies that I think could be reprioritized, reprogrammed, repackaged. You can think about the Farm Bill in particular and the energy title on the Farm Bill as some of those particular pieces that might support that going forward. And I'm not the only one that has any perspective on that. I'm sure these other gentlemen do too. So,
just briefly, we are not, there's a lot of things that would be helpful, but I think primarily it's just recognition and understanding of what we're offering. That is, it's a solution that's here now and half the price of heating oil, for example, and actually much less than that of propane. Propane in the Northeast is very, very expensive. It's a technology that exists. It's deployed. It's in literally almost a million homes in Europe, the home heating boilers that I'm talking about. But for some reason, when you get to the policy level, the perception is that it's primitive, dirty, and takes a lot of attention. It's sort of like the caveman sitting around a campfire or something is what you do with wood. What we do is we take a refined fuel, pellets, and burn it very cleanly, very efficiently, and automatically. But that knowledge is just not here. It's an unknown unknown technology in the U.S. pretty much. And just getting recognition and hearing reference to this solution in people's discussions would be a lot. You know, we're not asking for money. We're asking for recognition. I had a meeting a couple of weeks ago with the governor of Maine, talked about the economic benefits, and in the last 2 weeks, every time he's had a press conference or spoke in public, he's talking about how we need to include pellet fuel and pellet boilers as part of the portfolio of solutions for Maine's dependence on heating oil. It just takes a little work and a little education, and amazingly enough, the phones are ringing at the business. The sales guys can't keep up with it because we now have the bully pulpit, if you will, providing some support. That's a big ask, and it's actually a pretty easy one because there's no risk. It's a proven technology. It's here now, ready to go. We're not waiting for some breakthrough on biofuels or liquid fuel from wood or anything exotic or expensive. We're talking half the price of the current fuel in a system that's perfectly proven and works now. Easy.
I'll add to it maybe some specifics that we have been talking about. In the 111th Congress, Shaheen had several co-sponsors on a bill that was for American renewable biomass heating. I know. It was introduced in the 111th, and they're looking for additional co-sponsors in 112th. That's S-3188. Specifically. Senator Bingaman is also working on one that has to do with a little bit of a different structure in a two-tier section for investment tax credits, and I think that may tie into the Section 45. we do have traction that we've gained through the Farm Bill, and you know, not only is it Rural Energy for America program, the REAP, through Section, I'll probably get this wrong, 9,003, 7, something. One of those two, you can pick it, I'm not sure. But that's a great program, not just for grants or handouts, but also for loans to make these realities, you know, these potentials a reality. And then I'd also just mention that wood pellets, along with other non-corn-based biofuels, have been recognized as an advanced biofuel. And there's actually Section 9005, an advanced biofuel production payment. We certainly would like to hold on to the traction that we've gained there. But at the end of the day, I think most of us would all agree that recognizing it as a solution, getting more support, trying to drive the message home that this is a great affordable technology for more people in America than most of the existing renewables that can be chosen, not just for residential, but for, you know, for businesses, commercial, and institutional. I think it's driving that home, helping to advance that, is a big part of why we're all here.
Outside of pellets, do you guys see any opportunities for biomass to mature like other energy markets, like gold? What are some of the hurdles? How do you go about it?
I'll start. Most of the existing biomass market is not pellets currently. You know, the pellets provide a great opportunity. It's refined fuel, flowability. It helps with the scalability. But I guess to your question of, you know, what do I see? The biomass traditionally was primarily used, and it's called hog fuel, ground up wood, and it was really low value and kind of the dregs. And so the producing of that ended up often with a fair amount of dirt and contamination in that. And so I think one of the things that where the biomass energy picture needs to go is the development of different grades of fuel. And Stephen kind of mentioned that from the pellet standpoint, but I think within chips and ground up, the moisture content is a significant factor. The amount of contaminants, dirt, soil that might be mixed in there, how much bark, how much of the needles, you know, there are a number of factors, and I think those are also going to be really important when you start talking about the biofuels, the liquid fuels as well. And so the development of standards so that, you know, we've been talking about number 2 fuel oil or number 6 fuel oil that people burn in their boilers. You know, so those are standards that were developed many decades ago. We need to be developing that same sort of standards so that somebody that designs a boiler system, they know that, okay, you have to burn you know, the XYZ grade of fuel in this to meet the warranty on that boiler. And, you know, so right now we don't have that level of development. One of you guys.
I was just going to say, in this country, the American Society of Agricultural and Biological Engineers has been working with some of the ISO standards coming out of Europe, trying to blend across what Europe has done with fuel, principally chips and pellets, both, because that's where you can have a little bit of that. So there is some standards development coming.
Just to follow up on that, I mean, the Europeans have standards for chips.
Pellet Fuel Institute started 6 years ago developing and revising their pellet fuel standards, and we got a long way down the road towards a standardized measurement method for all the parameters. A year ago last spring, EPA came to the PFI conference and informed the PFI board and then the PFI membership that they supported what PFI was doing, but it was a voluntary program. And EPA said, we want you to make it involuntary, and we want you to have third-party verification and an extremely repetitive verification of what you're manufacturing, what you're putting in the bag, the bag list of contents with a certain minimum accuracy. And excuse me. And it was kind of like a sledgehammer in the head to the PFI co-producers. But EPA said, because we're reviewing and rewriting the new source performance standard for emissions from pellet burning appliances, we are going to mandate that all of them are tested for emissions and meet the EPA requirements for air emissions from these appliances. And because we're regulating the appliances, we can now regulate what fuel those appliances can burn, not unlike gasoline into an automobile. So we have had some help from Big Brother in putting together a very strict pellet fuel quality and standard and grade specification that is now rolling across our industry at a pretty rapid rate. And EPA said if 90%+ of your fuel manufacturers sign up for this program, then we'll leave you alone. But if they don't, then we will write the specification and we will enforce the grade and the fuel quality on their own parameters. So that's where we are today.
Any other questions? I think our speakers will be happy to hang around for a few minutes. We'd like to come up and check individually. But thank you for coming, and thank you to our speakers.